Thank you. Hi, everyone. We're so excited that you're joining us today. I'm Laura Thompson. I'm the Director of Education at MASS MoCA. And I'd like to welcome you and express my gratitude for your attention to these very important topics to be addressed in our new InSession programming. MASS MoCA and the Massachusetts College of Liberal Arts, better known as MCLA, are joining forces to establish a series of panel discussions to be held with community members, artists, and museum professionals with a lens on anti-racist work in museums. The first two panels, today and on January 21st, will feature artists and museum leaders addressing trauma and the consumption of art. The idea for this program came up in discussion with Shaun Leonardo, whose work we have currently on view in MASS MoCA, and which will move to the Bronx Museum of Art in the next year. Shaun has a history of working with the museum and me, dating back to when we had Nick Cave's Until exhibition up. And we invited Shaun to do his I Can't Breathe workshop for local teens. We have a lot more to look forward to as we spend the next 2 years on two other curatorial projects. So thank you, Shaun, for helping us guide this program into fruition. I also want to acknowledge my colleague, Erica Wall, who's the director of MCLA's Berkshire Cultural Resource Center and its Gallery 51, who's doing amazing work to bring more visibilities to BIPOC artists. Thank you for your wisdom and for helping to shape the program. Thank you to the panelists who will be speaking today from their homes in Baltimore, Cleveland, Chicago, and Brooklyn. And while I have the floor, thank you to the museum staff and leadership for helping with and supporting this program, this programming during very tumultuous times. Or if you don't mind me tooting our own horn, to quote Forbes journalist Chad Scott, quote, "Fortunately, there are institutions who've stepped up to the challenge of presenting difficult art through difficult times, assuring the work has context to engage and enlighten, not merely provoke. One such place is MASS MoCA," end quote. I'm now delighted to turn over the mic to Erica Wall.
Good evening, everyone. And I'd like to start off by thanking you, Laura Thompson, and the entire MASS MoCA staff for its continued support and commitment to partnering with the Berkshire Cultural Resource Center and the Massachusetts College of Liberal Arts. It's my great pleasure to be the one to introduce the very esteemed panel that we have assembled here today. We're grateful to each of them for graciously accepting our invitation. We've asked them to not only discuss and explore these pressing considerations facing our world and thus the art world today, but to also participate in the often uncomfortable processes of interrogation and problem solving that enable all of us to move forward to do the work of dismantling systemic racism. Our distinguished panel comprises a very celebrated and talented group of contemporary artists. Joining us this evening are Nick Cave, Shaun Leonardo, Xaviera Simmons, and Stephen Locke. Each artist continues to make immeasurable impact on the way in which the art world and institutions consider, face, and expand the conversation around social and racial justice. Dr. Kalima Young, gender rights activist and assistant professor in the Department of Electronic Media and Film at Towson University, will open and introduce our conversation. Then our moderator for the evening, M. Carmen Lane, will initiate our talk. Again, many thanks to all of you for attending. It's my pleasure now to welcome Dr. Young to begin this evening's program. Dr. Young.
Thank you very much, Erica. And thank you all. I'm looking forward to chatting with you. I'm going to share my screen because I added some things to the talk that's going to occur that will hopefully act as a framing device that we can all build off of. So let me do this process here. Okay. You should be seeing the screen, I would hope. Yes. All right. Let me get it started. So I call this conversation, when I was asked to frame this conversation, I decided that I would frame it around something that I've been studying a lot as one who researches the impact of gender and racial-based trauma on Black identity, Black cultural production, and Black media. And it's this concept of empathetic witnessing that I want us to engage with. So what makes one a member of a collective? According to sociology, three components create the conditions for the formation of collective identity. One, the collectivity has continuity over time and tries to adapt to its social and political environment. Two, the collectivity is differentiated and distinguished with respect to other collectivities. And three, the collectivity is able to recognize itself and be recognized by others. Collective identity is not only derived from the process of interaction, but from the repeated identity activations that a group undergoes as it negotiates self-identification. Interwoven in this negotiation of collective identity is one's feelings of allegiance to that particular group. Cultural traumas often act as identity activations that have the power to bridge the gap across multiple social identities, social locations, and standpoints. So cultural trauma That occurs when members of a collective feel that they've been subjected to a horrendous event that leaves an undeniable mark upon their group consciousness, marking their memories forever and changing their future identity in fundamental ways. Cultural trauma is not solely about a group's members experiencing each other's pain. It's about the group viewing the traumatic event as fundamental to their collective identity. Something about the occurrence resonates in the psyche and validates the collective's reality. Mediated and artistic representations of cultural trauma influence our collective memories of these occurrences. So many of us, I know I wasn't, many of us were not in New York in 2001 when the towers fell. But narratives of these events, as well as the excess visual and auditory artifacts in the telling of these narratives, shape our memory of that fateful day. Repetition is the means through which culture processes and creates a sense of traumatic events. By refashioning representations of cultural trauma, artists often invite us to create new collective memories. Sometimes those memories reinscribe humanity onto those who have been stripped of it. Other times, this refashioning contributes to the creation of icons. Let us consider the image of Trayvon Martin. The phrase, "I am Trayvon Martin," carries an excess of cultural weight. And the image, the hoodie, the halo, the downward cast eyes, all invite questions. Trayvon Martin is an icon. All of the deaths of young Black and Brown children are captured in one selfie that has been circulated, remixed, and reimagined. Discussing racial icons, Nicole Fleetwood suggests we try to see the beautiful face of a Black teenage boy seeking recognition through a selfie, rather than the floodgate of emotions and historical baggage that we've foisted upon his image. But how does an artist acknowledge cultural trauma for the collective while maintaining the individuality of those who are no longer with us? When an artist creates ways for the audience to see the interiority of victims of violence, while also validating our collective trauma, a deeper, more empathetic witnessing can occur. Why is this important? Because it combats the numbness and disengagement that undergirds our society of spectacle. Images of Black pain, wounding, and death are common in the American imaginary and have served many different purposes for white and Black Americans. What is unique about this moment is the viral nature of these images and the intimate technology that's used to capture them. Viral videos and cellular phones are indicative of a society of spectacle and surveillance. In a society of spectacle, we place primacy on the visual. Everyone is a media consumer, a media maker, and a user. We are saturated with repetitive narratives that render audiences passive. A surveillance society refers to the growth of technologies that track and monitor our everyday lives. It also refers to our willingness to monitor ourselves and one another. In a surveillance society, sharing viral images of pain is a part of a larger system of impression management. It reflects the need for users to immediately respond, be engaged, have an opinion, and influence opinions, often in an online environment. A society of spectacle and surveillance helps to create the conditions by which viral images of Black death is normalized. Spectacle is a powerful technology for erasing victimhood status from those who are impacted by unconscionable acts. For some, the process of watching and sharing viral videos turns Black bodies into a de-individuated mass. And even the most truthful accounts of injustices against Black people are repeatedly distorted by histories of racist reading practice and endless media spectacle. This complicates our reliance on dashboard cameras, police body cameras, Facebook feeds, and yes, even artist galleries as a means to garner justice. In a visually saturated world of repetitive narratives and sentiments, the keen eye of an artist can act as a tool to interrupt the spectacle. Artists who choose to work with cultural trauma imagery are engaging in what I call a politics of interruption. It's a commitment to cut through the cacophony of media saturation. These artists are not only making the interior exterior, they are also creating the archive of memory with which to understand this contemporary moment of cultural trauma. Artists who engage with cultural trauma allow themselves to become survivors by proxy. Now, this idea of a survivor by proxy is an artist. This term is originally coined in trauma studies. And what it does is that it suggests that those who bear witness to trauma become survivors of that trauma themselves. So when an artist sits with an image, even one that has been saturated and circulated and remixed and reimagined, when they sit with the footage or the images and try to create a response, they are opening themselves up to being survivors by proxy. But to bear witness enough to become a survivor by proxy, one must engage in a level of empathetic witnessing. So in my investigation into the witnessing practices of Black cultural workers in Baltimore, I discovered that many Black artists who engage with instances of cultural trauma deploy empathetic witnessing practices. This practice is a three-step process. It starts first with witnessing the trauma, what I like to call showing up as an artist. Next, that worker processes the trauma through their artistic medium, which I call engaging the experience with the tool. And finally, the Black cultural worker outputs that story, representing the consciousness of the community. Empathetic witnessing is a whole body process, which uses the painful identity activations, an artist's tools, and an artist's willingness to embody the collective's pain to properly represent the cultural trauma of the community. This act of representation not only validates the reality of those who are marginalized, it also further supports the site of trauma and mourning, those sticky sites that we're going to be talking about in this panel discussion, as a productive place for the creation of collective identity and a resistance to spectacle society. Artists who engage in cultural trauma work are not ineffable, nor are they impervious to the trappings of a spectacle society. Artists can and do cause harm. I've identified two contexts in which this harm often occurs. First, when artists engage in acts of empty empathy. And second, when the cultural institutions that work with artists do not overtly acknowledge their role in perpetuating cultural trauma. We live in a society of spectacle where media consumption, media convergence, and the primacy of visual communication intersect. Empty empathy occurs when we're invited to empathize with individuals who experience trauma without being provided the larger context of the existence of their trauma. In this context, we get empathy, that's empty. To fulfill the desire to take part in a larger conversation surrounding a cultural trauma, artists often create spontaneous work and responses. Though their responses contribute to the moment's immediacy, they can cause great harm by relying on sentimentality as the primary messenger. I want to drill in this specifically as it relates to cultural trauma that's experienced by Black women and girls. In The Suffering Will Not Be Televised, Rebecca Wanzo traces the invisibility of Black women's suffering to illustrate the way Black women's pain, wounding, and death have been excluded from media narratives about social violence and victimization. Black women have been denied the ability to tap into what Wanzo calls sentimental political storytelling. Black women have been denied this ability and the ability to have their pain narrativized for sympathy. Sentimental stories are texts that represent history, events, people, and or conflicts in simplistic emotional binaries. And they're designed to produce tears and joy of willfulness and joy in the consumer and represent emotion in a way that's far from the complexity of how affect actually works in reality. Sometimes the sentimental can be pushed for justice and the formulation of new campaigns. But sometimes sentimental narratives lead to an overabundance of cartoon victims, cartoon villains, cartoon justice, and empty empathy. Black women, even young Black girls, are not afforded the purity of innocent victimhood status that garners a sentimental reading of their pain. Let us think about the memification of Breonna Taylor, right? So Breonna Taylor's image during this summer's uprising, it took mere weeks for memes calling for the arrest of her murderers to become viral misogynoir. The ongoing tendency to meet Black pain, especially Black female pain, with the digital blackface is all too common. Digital blackface describes the types of minstrel performance that become available in our digital realm and our society as spectacle, from using GIFs of Black women to show confusion to repurposing videos of Black people in traumatic experiences for fun and for jingles, like Sweet Brown Wilkins' story of her house burning down. These maneuvers, especially when applied to Black women and girls, position their actions as exaggerated and excessive enough that others can embody them for their own emotional lives. Breonna Taylor's meme distortion illustrates how viral misogynoir travels in environments where multiple relational scripts prevent Black women and girls from being seen as embodied beings with subjectivity. In a society of spectacle, we tend to read the stories of violence as singular episodes rather than evidence of systemic oppression. But context matters now more than ever. And cultural institutions play a pivotal role in providing the context. So what's the role of the cultural institution in this entire conversation? Marita Sturkin says, the self-image of the United States as innocent has been key to the national identity throughout much of American history. This belief affirms the US as a country of pure intentions and grand exceptionalism that is never to blame for the harms it endures. She goes on to posit, this investment in reaffirming innocence not only functions to mask US imperialist policies and the history of the US as an active history of empire, but also obscures the degree to which violent conflict has been fundamental in US society. Museums, galleries, and monuments are active agents of the US as they contribute to the creation and the maintenance of the nation state. These cultural institutions are where we archive memory, make sense of cultural trauma, and occasionally reclaim voices that have been lost to history. They're also locations where the battle between stakeholders, those who claim ownership of a story, and the historic record take shape. With every exhibition, galleries, museums, and monuments must decide if they are forums or if they are temples. Which role do you play? This is an important distinction A forum is a place or a meeting or medium where ideas and views on a particular issue can be exchanged. A temple is a container devoted to worship and reverence. David Blight says, memory is often owned. History is interpreted. Memory is passed down through generations. History is revised. Cultural institutions have an obligation to decide if they are doing memory work or history work. Regardless if one believes forums are inherently liberalizing spaces for discourse, or that temples are places of solemnity and reflection, neither of these containers can free themselves from being agents of an imperialist project, nor can they totally divorce themselves from a society of spectacle. But when cultural institutions, working with artists engaging in a politics of interruption, decide the kind of work they are doing and the kind of container they are making, they at least have a starting point to combat empty empathy. So with these framings, devices in mind, how do we show up to cultural trauma as artists? How do we cultivate a politics of interruption? And what conditions do you need to be able to engage in empathetic witnessing practices? Thanks. I'm gonna stop sharing my screen. That's what I'm gonna do.
Thank you so very much. If I put the screen, I would probably help myself. But thank you so very much for that amazing, insightful, and comprehensive introduction, Dr. Young. I'd now like to introduce to you our moderator for the evening, a two-spirit African-American Haudenosaunee Mohawk Tuscarora artist, educator, facilitator, and founding director of the Ada Insick Center for Healing and Creative Leadership in Cleveland, Ohio, M. Carmen Lane. Welcome, Carmen, and thank you so very much for joining us. I'll now hand it over to you to begin this evening's conversation.
Thank you, Erica. I want to first start with a land acknowledgement, and not in the sense of acknowledging a site where a building sits, but to acknowledge that this conversation is particular and peculiar in the ways in which people of African descent in the Americas or Black people are living in the United States, this place we call the United States. So for me, this is the container of the work and the conversation that the artist will be speaking in. And that is the container for meaning making. I'd like to share my screen just for a moment. Stephen Locke, one of the panelists, posted this image last week to acknowledge the anniversary of the murder of Fred Hampton. The image to the right is the response that the artist Elizabeth Catlett produced. So I want us to take a moment as audience and as panel to invite into this container our ancestors to support a conversation that is not new and potentially will never be old. So as I listen to the call from Dr. Young to invite us to think about the conditions to interrupt, I want to say something about the role of the audience, that is Dr. Young's notion of empathetic witnessing, that is your task this evening, to practice the potentiality of that. And for the panelists, I simply invite you to have the conversation that you want to have with each other and allow it to be witnessed. So I want to take a moment for you to think about what you took in from Dr. Young. And and locate yourself in this notion of what the conditions are. So how do you want to introduce yourself? And how do you want to build on the ideas from one another? How do you want to take in both the similarities of the container in which you occupy as a human being and as an artist? And how do you invite a divergent voice into your conversation with each other? So with that, anyone can begin to name yourself, your location, and what the conditions are for interruption as a human being and in your practice.
I'm happy to begin. My name is Shaun Leonardo, and I have the great pleasure and honor of helping organize this panel, and I am also exhibiting as MASS MoCA, as Erica and Laura pointed out. I'm calling in from Brooklyn, where I'm here with my family in solitude. The way I show up today and the way that I connect with Kalima's words has very much to do with how I see a physical experience with a work of art. And I will acknowledge that I have Steve's recent writing in art news or art forum, that is, ringing in my head. And the one thing I want to point out is this idea that the institutional responsibility to our experience and the ways in which, and Kalima, I think you put it so beautifully, the ways in which our lived experience and an institution's responsibility to that is not just as a container for art, but because they are the container for history and the way that we see our own stories being told or not. And so when I think about empathetic witnessing, I think about all of the context of place and time, the context of hurt, the context of distrust, the context of alienation that we carry with us in our witnessing, in our seeing, that is influenced. And this, I said this in a recent engagement with the MASS MoCA staff, the front of house staff, that is reactivated the moment you walk into the building. That our history of relationships with institutions is reactivated in our bodies the moment we open the door to that institution. And we carry with that, all of that, what we carry in terms of our lived experience all provides a filter to how we see. But then there's the space in between you and the work of art. And something else happens there. The other information doesn't move away necessarily, because that's embedded within us. But then there's a different possibility in which a work of art can tell us something, can give us meaning, and can also teach us how we wish to exist in the world. And that, I still dare say, transcends our context of the moment that we live in, if a work of art functions the way it should. I'll leave it there.
Well, I'll go. I'm Steve Locke. I'm in Brooklyn. I would be remiss if I did not wish my stepfather, Sam Locke, firefighter, a happy 80th birthday today. I love you very much. And I'm in Brooklyn. I'm alone, as I've been since the beginning of this pandemic. I just finished teaching, so I am on the unwind of giving all that time and energy to my wonderful students. I have never really been interested in trauma, to be completely honest with you. I have been interested in justice. And for me, I think that the work of an artist, even though there are people who are art therapists, and that is a very important and powerful job, the work of healing is not mine to do. my work is to make you look and to make you unable to look away. And from the entire time of my career, from my work dealing with the annihilation of a group of people from the AIDS epidemic until now, I've been engaged in an active assault on spectacle culture, right? And I think that that's something that all of us on this panel have in common, in that we're all highly trained. We all deeply understand all of the theory and all of the books. We all read Alain Badiou. We all read Society of the Spectacle. We all understand the Situationist International. We all understand radical art politics. We have assimilated all that stuff. So we are experts in our field. And my problem comes when people don't trust Black cultural producers as artists. They want to reframe us as shamans or mystics or dancing monkeys or people who are bringing entertainment. You know, I've never wanted to be any of those things. I only wanted to be an artist. And as James Baldwin says, if I love you, I have to tell you the truth. So my job, as I see it, is to tell the truth and to do it through art, not through media, okay? Not through commercials, not through entertainment, right? Which is a whole different thing. And the beauty of art is that it is not delivered to people at a place that makes them most comfortable. It's not an episode of Breaking Bad, right? It is delivered at a place that is sacred. I'm the son of an auto worker. I grew up in Detroit, Michigan. The Detroit Institute of Arts saved my life. A museum space was a space of safety, of engagement, of beauty, and of power. So I believe firmly in art. I believe firmly in the institutions that hold art. I have never paid attention to anyone who told me I did not belong. I've never paid attention to it. And I have my mother to thank for that. So that's all.
And I'll go next. I'm Xaviera Simmons, and I'm in New York right now, in Manhattan. I will always say I'm a descendant of slavery on all sides of my lineage. And the reason why I say that is when Carmen just showed those two images, my heart is beating fast and it literally took my breath away, because the Catlett's, Elizabeth Catlett's family are like my, they're basically my family, you know, like her granddaughters are my best friends. And so it's kind of making me a little teary eyed. And thinking of Chairman Fred Hampton, Elizabeth Catlett, descendant of slavery, very close. Chairman Fred Hampton, descendant of slavery. And I think about lineage and time and their life conditions and what has been, you know, taken from us because, you know, Fred Hampton's death and Elizabeth Catlett's having to leave this country because she was accused of being communist and all that happened after that, and also being a descendant of slavery and what that meant for her production as an artist. And, you know, putting those two images together for me, it kind of, you know, Fred Hampton's son is still trying to get a museum produced of the house where Chairman Hampton was assassinated, I think, or built or raised as a child. And Elizabeth Catlett's family also has, you know, archival materials and all kinds of things that help us understand her life and her art production. So, you know, I think about the challenges. I know some of them personally because they are, you know, family members basically. And then I know them from afar. And I think about, I know people who are on this call, who maybe have seen me talk before or who are friends of mine, will recognize the repetition in what I'm saying, in that above all of this is the need for white people individually and collectively, part of institutions, professors, artists, thinkers, priests, I don't know, the whole lot of you have to do the work. Because at the end of the day, having us continually undo and unravel and show and explain what has been said for generations on our side of the line is actually traumatizing. And it actually belittles our intellectual capacity, and it also turns us into repetitive human beings. And it also makes us continuously magnify the trauma of what we're seeing caused by the actions that you are doing. So for me, being here, seeing those images, it's actually made me land. So thank you, Carmen, for showing those particular two images personally to me. Thank you, Professor Kalima Young, for all that you said. But at the end of the day, what I really want to say is that whiteness, I've said this so many times, so I sound like a broken record. Whiteness is the witness that must undo itself. Whiteness, the construction of it, the holder of it, the powers that are in the bank accounts, the reserves, the resources, all of it. You either are going to decide that you want more for this group of people and all of the Black folks who descend from slavery, all of the First Nations people, all of the people that you know, even your poor white brethren, you have to decide that you want more for this collective that is now, we are trapped together, literally. I can't leave. I like to go to Europe very often. I cannot leave. I'm trapped with you. Now is an amazing time to get us out of this repetition of having to face trauma. I would like this panel to actually be white folks talking about the history of lynching and their ancestors who are pictured inside of those images and a whole bunch of other conversations. So that's where I'm sitting when you show me an image of Fred Hampton, Elizabeth Catlett sculpture that's tied directly to my own family lineage, and then thinking about the topics that we have come here to talk about.
Hello, everyone. I'm Nick Cave. Glad to be here with everyone. I think I'm going to start off by saying that I'm a messenger first, artist second, educator third. But I'm actually a social and civic agent using art as a vehicle for change. What I have sort of discovered recently within myself is that going forward in my practice, it's only going to be about Black excellence. And standing fully in that, you know, I never have fully stood in it, but no more. It's time to stand fully in it and for everyone else to embrace it and realize that it's real, real. And so I'm so excited about the work going forward. I'm not going to be, I realize what's going on within my world, around my world, everything that we're talking about, I get it. But I have to also be in this sort of space of reimagining. You know, we're always reimagining ourselves as people of color. because we're always put in these sort of moments where we have to sort of rethink about who we are, our identity, where we stand, what we believe, what we stand up for. That's a common, that's an everyday. But for me to stand in my Black excellence, I can't wait, I'm so thrilled. I'm just so like excited about what that is going to look like. So I'm glad to be here with everyone.
So for me, there's two themes running in what I'm hearing you say to each other and to the audience. And I would like to delineate, right, the experience of being embodied in one's practice as an artist and as a Black person experiencing racism in this system and thoughts about that from whiteness. So I think it's important both for the audience and for this conversation that we can think about and imagine both what Nick is suggesting. You know, I know what the environment is, and this is my purpose. So I'd love for you all to connect at the intersections of each one of your identified purpose as artist, as cultural producer, as interrupter, as messenger, as educator, as parent even. Rachel Elizabeth Harding speaks about what she calls a Black indigeneity, that there's something in the reimagining of our lives as people of African descent based on the change of place. And so it's a skill set that we have to play with. So I'm curious about your perception of the role of artists in that continual play. What's your intervention style? And how does it speak to interrupting the things that you have named in this audience?
Well, I'm happy to chime in again. And I think it very much has to do with the fact that I deeply believe that a large collective we have failed in witnessing. And I think it's influenced by the factors named by Kalima and Dr. Young in the ways in which we are in a mode of rapidity, excess, and a renewed, if not inflated, society of spectacle. And so my purpose, actually I refer back to something Steve told me long, long ago. It's not when and if we look, it's how we look. And I find it necessary then to interject this, that there must be a distinction between works of art that offer pause, slowness, versus the repetition of moving image. And that how we receive information from moving image is different than a still image. And a still image is different than a photo. Excuse me, it's different than a painting. A painting is different than a drawing. And the reason why, going back to something also Dr. Young said, that I grapple with this painful image through drawing is because it allows me to process things on my own terms, on my own time, and to quite literally sculpt an image out of a tool and a blank fucking piece of paper. And it's in that time, it's in that deliberate carving out of a thing that I can offer some other way of looking that changes someone seeing into witnessing. Because I do believe there's a lost art to it, there's a lost intentionality to it, and a lost purpose in the way that we receive and internalize all of this mess.
I just have to respond to Shaun and say, I mean, I know Shaun's work very intimately and I've known it for a really long time. But I am going to disagree with you here. And this is disagreement out of love. We know each other pretty well, so you know me. But I am going to say that I actually don't believe there's a failure to witness. The United States has kept exquisite records of all of the trauma that it has inflicted. It also has, individual families have kept exquisite records of witnessing the trauma. There's narratives for days. You can't even gobble them up. I have so many books just waiting for me to gobble up about the witnessing. We have PhDs at every university. They're churning out witnesses and observers. And for me, the failure is not in the hands, particularly of Black people. It's right. Not in the hands. The failure has to do with the institution and the people, you know, those with the most resources, and the failure to repair. Their failure to repair previously and the continual failure to repair. At the end of the day, the witnessing has been held and had, but we need to move on from the witnessing and into the living fully. And to be a full American citizen requires a lot of resources individually, and it requires a lot of care, especially at this juncture. And so for me, I'm actually tired of the witnessing. I want the next space, which is actually, I thought I would disagree with Nick when he was saying Black excellence, because I don't really think about Black excellence in that way. But in this juncture, I actually am gonna hold that and hold what he's saying, because I'm good with the witnessing and the PhDs. I want the repair and the living. And, you know, it's particularly when we think about Nick's work, it's living, it's alive, it is vibrant, it is stunning. And yes, we do need witnesses, but not to the degree that we do where we're having these conversations pretty much on a daily basis at this point. So that's where I'm gonna disagree with you, with care, with love, and with respect.
I think that I am sort of in the middle of these two conversations, which are so powerful, because I do strongly believe that the act of witnessing is crucial, especially for someone who's making images and objects. And that for people act like things don't affect artists. Like we're somehow in a bunker and we're making these images and we don't have any feelings about them, right? And that's not true. I sat down and drew almost 100 white people who murdered Black people. Like I had feelings about each and every one of those portraits, and that's why I did it, right? So that notion that the act of working is a way to stay in the world. If I did not have art, I would not be able to remain in the world, right? And so the other part of this is the notion that somehow people have conflated an image of Shaun's work on Instagram with the actual trauma, right? And that is a failure of intelligence. It's a failure of education, and it's a failure of media studies. That's where the failure is. When people are looking at an Instagram image and making comments about it, and then an institution gets so afraid that they're gonna upset Black people by showing this work, that is a failure of support of the artist. It's a failure of curatorial vision, right? The artist has done their work. And when you have an artist like Shaun, who is actually incredibly adept at working in and with and across communities, to not leverage his brilliance in having a conversation with the community is curatorial malpractice, right? So that's what we're talking about here. Like, people can misunderstand images all they want. That's fine. But an institution has a job to do, which is to educate its community inside its walls and outside its walls, right? And stop throwing artists under the bus like, oh, you made a bad image. You made something that was that hurt people. Like the assumption that someone is going to go into a studio, that Shaun Leonardo is going to go into a studio to make an image specifically to hurt people is asinine in the extreme. And for an institution to actually support that kind of critique of Shaun's work is disgusting. It's just disgusting. And so now we're here at MASS MoCA, which had the courage to show the work. And now we're having a conversation, a meta conversation about the work, right? When the truth of the matter is that the work is about whiteness and how it erases Black life, right? So I'm ready to have that conversation. I'm ready to sit down with all the white people and have that conversation. I'm fine with that, right? But like this notion that somehow we are traumatizing Black people with art, they just tried to throw out the votes of all the Black people in 5 states. That's what's happening to Black people right now, right? So don't talk to me about this, right? Because it has less to do with art and more to do with the museum's role, as Dr. Young said, either to be a temple or to be a site or to be a forum. And I believe that the museum can be both. But right now, some museums are choosing to be temples. Right.
Yeah, and I think that we have to stand up for our truth and in our truth. You know, when I think about institutions, you know, they're working for me. And this is the mindset that I have to stay with. I'm, you know, at the end of the day, this is an opportunity for me. And, you know, I'm always asking myself, what are my responsibilities beyond just being this sort of maker? You know, everybody's talking about outreach. Everyone's talking about community sort of service and sort of trying to change the sort of dynamics of that. But what can I do to help facilitate those ideas? And so part of my sort of, I'm not, you know, I think the art part is probably the least interesting to me as opposed to the outreach. I'm going to make sure that I see myself in the museum. And so I'm going to sort of pull up my sleeves, put on my boots and get into the community. I'm no longer interested in waiting for anybody. And so I think that, you know, as an artist, nor am I ever going to make sacrifices anymore. This is where I'm at. This is what I believe. This is what I need, that needs to happen. And if you can support it, great. If you can't, I got to keep moving. You know, the fact that I think about this idea of disruption in my practice, that I think about like George Floyd, as I was working on this new body of work and that happened, I had to accept the disruption in my practice. And so what I thought I was making literally did a 90 degree turn because I had to fold that now into this work. And that's okay because I'm more interested in being present with myself, my full self. And if there's disruptions in the moment, it's disruptions in the moment. And whatever that looks like, I've got to be open to accepting that as I have to be open to accepting to the moment. And so, you know, this sort of way of sort of, you know, I feel like I'm just constantly on top of this sort of like, I'm creating this balance act that, you know, I'm trying to move on this parallel line, and yet I'm sort of pivoting as I'm moving down it, trying to like stay steady fast. But I've learned to fold it all into the moment, because I have to stay present with my truth and with myself. And just doing that takes everything. I mean, I was thinking the other day, just imagining like, wow, you know, if there wasn't racism, what would I be making today? Like, what kind of work would I be making? That's interesting to me to think about that.
Like Toni Morrison says that, you know, the real function of racism is to distract you from your work.
Right.
You know, you always end up talking about something that you're not interested in talking about. Personally, like if I could do a curatorial project, you know what I would like to do? I would like to do a show about Betty Woodman. You know what I mean? Like, because I love that work. It's something I love. It's something, and I would like to pair her with Mary Cassatt and like have a whole like conversation about that. Talk about where those objects came from and the role of the domestic and like all that sort of stuff. Like that's the kind of thing that I think about. Like I'm not just sitting around all day thinking about how painful it is to be Black, because I never thought it was painful to be Black. I never thought Black people were the problem. Like I never did. Like, and people would call me names and stuff like that, and horrible white kids in Detroit, which has a real problem with like racism. Like they would say these things to me and I thought, well, that's about them. Those people are garbage. Like I didn't think that that was about me. I certainly didn't think that was about me. And so that whole idea about standing up in Black excellence, like that's powerful stuff to give that to a child. Like, and I feel fortunate that, you know, I had like the connection to Detroit, to the Black Panther Party, to all those different things growing up, because I never thought that there was something wrong with being Black. I thought it was great, right? But now I come along and I hear that Black people are pathological and they're traumatized and they're victims and they're all this other sort of stuff. And I'm like, you know, I don't want to be that. Like, I know that like the shit comes the way the shit comes. And like Nick was saying, I have to live with it. And I've got to incorporate it into my life because I got to go on. Like there's no stopping. Can't stop, won't stop. I got to go on, right? And I'll be damned if I let people destroy me because of racism. You know, like, no, baby, no.
There's no, I'm talking as if we're just talking to each other, because I'm talking in my, like, the way I would be speaking. Just listening to you, what you're saying, Steve, I'm just thinking, you know, and also to what Nick's saying, my word, when I think racism, immediately the word whiteness comes in. Like that word racism doesn't make sense to me anymore, right? Because I understand what it is and what I'm looking at. So it just, that immediately replaces, I work with language so much that I understand what it's trying to cover and what it's trying to do. And I've actually gotten to the point where I don't blame, and this is tough, you know, because I know that individuals and groups do things to each other. But in the United States, I actually almost pretty close to not being able to blame a single Black person for anything that they do. And it's a strange feeling to have, but when you understand the threads of the history of this country, really understand it deeply. Like I've walked this country. My father owned funeral homes, so all he did was deal with death. Mm-hmm. My grandmother was, you know, involved with the Black church in Harlem. So all she did was deal with the great migration coming through. And all of that comes in through my work. And through all of that and understanding the trauma, drama of family and all of it, I do not blame Black people pretty much for anything that they do, because You cannot be 13% of the population. You cannot, and I've said this before, you cannot live in Boston and have your median net worth be $5.
Right.
And have the white people around you be worth 200 some odd thousand dollars. You right. cannot live in Harlem and have this, you cannot be a wandering tribe in the land that you built by hand. Mm-hmm. And then you've been terrorized out of every place. And then you've been disenfranchised out of even building. I can't, there's no like local soul food restaurant where I live unless I cook it.
Right.
What the fuck, to be real honest.
Right.
So the everything that's traumatic about the United States, particularly, has to do with the construction of divergent groups of people that now have formed themselves into being called white. Right. And all of the resources they have decided to keep for themselves and have us fight over. And all of these other conversations all stem from that. And it's annoying because it's like, stop saying that, right? Like, stop saying that. Like, I want to move on.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And there is a path to moving on that many people, Toni Morrison, Audre Lorde, Nick Cave, Shaun Leonardo, Steve Locke, all of us can give you a prescription for what is ailing this country. You just have to take it. The institutions right. have to take it now. You have to take it mm-hmm. for a long time. Take it.
Can I jump in there just a bit? Everything that I'm hearing from y'all, it's just affirming the reasons why my research looks at the impact of race and gender-based trauma on Black identity, Black cultural production, and Black media. My work comes from a space of understanding that Black folks have lived quite alive and vibrantly and beautifully under the specter of death. Mm-hmm. Why do we have to care about what white people think about how Black people are witnessing? How are we doing the work? How are we showing up in our everyday? How are we getting it done? And this idea for me has always just been freeing. I don't see trauma as a bad place. I see like the idea of working in cultural trauma as an actual, that's an important space to be, right? Yeah. Like Anna Zing, environmental feminist scholar, says like, one stick alone is just a stick. You rub two sticks together, you get heat and light. And these spaces of friction, that's where some of your most productive shit comes. That's where we make the new ways of existing in the world, interacting with one another, freeing ourselves from the white gaze, because who the hell cares about it? It's there, they're gonna go and be a hot mess where they need to be. But Black folks are gonna live and thrive and be vibrant and engage in ways that always support Black excellence, right? And these institutions, temples,
right?
The forums or temples have to decide where they're going to be in that process, because we're gonna keep on keeping on. So it's just something that I just want to add in there.
Carmen, I just have to add one thing. Carmen, if I may, because I have to come off of that point. And actually what I'm going to say, I believe is more, you will feel like more in alignment or in agreement with you, Zai. I work with young men and women that have been arrested and are on a daily basis persecuted by the so-called criminal justice system. And I tell these folks all the time that I invest myself in my practice in them because I want them to do something more than just survive. Right. We know the pain already. And I say we, now Black and Brown folks, that we do try to discard these images of death and violence because we are in a survival mode. If it does not occur to my body, I need to try to dispel it and discard it because I have to think about my care. I have to think about my day tomorrow. And yet those images will never go away.
Right.
They're housed within us. And so I always argue that in order to find healing, in order to find that chapter of joy and that place of excellence and that place of beauty, that we have to create a path through the trauma and hurt, not away from it. And I deeply believe that art as a vehicle can allow for that.
Hear, hear. Yeah.
Sometimes we got to be uncomfortable together.
So one of the things I'm witnessing in my role as moderator is here and now Black trauma. And I'm feeling it in my heart. It's emanating. And it's making me think about this very basic formula for behavior that the social psychologist Kurt Lewin developed. He was a refugee scholar from Nazi Germany to the US. And he said that behavior is the function of the person in the environment. So in the context of all these data points that we're putting into this conversation, these repetitions are systemic because they have a purpose and function in the structure of the environment. And in that vein, what is the function of the artist, and specifically the function of a Black artist, if that resonates in any way?
I think it's very hard to, you know, this has been a long conversation among Black creators about what the role of the Black artist is. You know, the reading Mounting Frustration, a wonderful book about the sort of moment in the 70s between abstraction and figurative art. Black people are supposed to make a certain kind of art. Black people are supposed to uplift the race. We're supposed to make positive images of Blackness. We're supposed to be role models and all this sort of stuff that I was never really interested in because I was queer. And so I wasn't going to be anybody's Black role model. They sidelined Bayard Rustin after building the March on Washington. So like, I sort of understood that that was like a sort of cisgendered male centric idea about validity, right? But I also realized, and this goes to something that is crucial in my own practice, like I don't need to make images of Black people to make them noble. I don't have to do that. Black people are already noble. And I don't believe in magic. I don't believe in any of that stuff. And I don't mean to offend anybody when I say that, but Black people aren't magic. Bullets don't bounce off us. We can't fly. And so all this sort of, all that kind of imagery is just as dehumanizing to Black people as caricature, right? Black people are real people. I really want justice for Black people, but I also want the 20-year-old Black guy to be able to sit and get stoned and play Xbox all day long, just like his white counterpart. Like, I want that. Like, I'm tired that Black people always have to be these amazing, incredible transport. Like, I just want to be an everyday guy, right? And I think Black people get the right to have that. And that's the sort of source of Black joy. Like, you get to have an everyday life. And that's what you see in, when you look through photo albums of Black families, what you see is everyday life chronicled in a way, right? I also don't look to the culture to affirm me. Never have, because the culture doesn't really care about me. So what I had to do as an artist is like, I had to start to create the culture, right? And so you don't have culture in America without Black people. I hate to break it to y'all, but there is no culture in America without Black people. There, you're left with like maybe Let's Make a Deal or something without Black people. That's probably as good as it gets. But I think that's Fran Lebowitz said that. You're left with Let's Make a Deal. When you take the gay version, when you take gay people out of American life, you're left with Let's Make a Deal. I think it's Black people too. But also this other thing about being a Black artist, I can see myself in The Great Gatsby, right? I can see myself in Mansfield Park. I can see myself in Beloved. I can see myself in the paintings of John Singer Sargent. The fact that I can see myself in American culture and white people cannot see themselves in Black lives, that's the problem. When you look at Black trauma, When you racialize trauma in that way, what you're saying is, this can't happen to me. This is the trauma that Black, this can only happen to Black people. Did Heather Heyer experience Black trauma when white supremacists murdered her? Did Viola Liozzo experience Black trauma when the Klan murdered her? Did Goodman and Schwerner experience Black trauma when the Klan murdered them? Did James Reeb experience Black? No, no. White supremacy is a death cult. It is a death cult. It will kill Black people. And then when it's done with Black people, it will turn on itself. You're seeing it right now. You're seeing it happen right now in this country. So this whole idea about being a Black artist is a gift, because I have the embodied sensibility of, like Xavi said, of a people who are descendant, who built this country, descendant from the enslaved. That is my legacy as well. And I'm just as American as everybody else. And what is shocking to me is that I can see myself in America. It is my home, it is my country. America refuses to see itself in me. And that's the crux of the problem.
I think it's something to be said, Stephen, that, you know, the first mass-produced cultural product that the U.S. has ever created, our first folk culture, is minstrelsy. Right? I think it's something to be said about how embedded Blackness is to the American identity from jump.
Aren't Black people the first mass-produced Black people who just the descend from slavery? Aren't we the first mass-produced people after you get with the contact with the First Nations people, right? Aren't we like the first object, really? Because then we became objects for close to 300 years.
We became the wealth of the country. We became objects for transfer and sale. People could mortgage us in order to get more money. We were the financial engine of this country.
In this moment, it also feels like we're materials for use. And we're a materiality for investigation.
Always.
Because I'm having a hard time finding questions for you from this audience. Because it's not tracking back to you or to your work or your practice. I'm receiving questions about white people, about white institutions, about responsibilities of whiteness. And so the impact on me is, how do you demonstrate in your conversation with each other simply who you are and how you embody your practice?
I'm going to say this, because the question was, how do we demonstrate? And I appreciate that, Carmen. I continue to find purpose in excavating truth because of what art gave me as a young brown person from humble background who was never even offered the notion that I could be an artist. And yet, I got to learn about possibilities of existence that would otherwise not have been in my view, because I watched and finally found a space where I could see work like Nick Cave's, where I could see work of Pablo Picasso, and say to myself, well, there's something else that I can, that I'm able to see here that is offering me a different possibility for how I can exist in the world, and no one else is talking to me about this. And I'd like to do that for someone else. I think that's what it comes down to it for me.
Well, you know, Shaun, I see you show up and do that work. You know, you do that work in community. And I use the word community in a very liberal sort of way. But also, you know, to when you were my colleague at Pratt, you know, the sort of the generosity with the students, the being present with the students, being present with all the students. You know, and being critical, you know, like there's something to be said for having, being in an institution that is primarily white, right? And you have a teacher who's a person of color. And for a lot of the students that I encounter, Shaun, me, Nick, we are their first educator of color that they've ever had, right? The first person to ever grade them, the first person to ever criticize them, the first person to ever tell them do something over, right? And that work is exhausting because you often run up against people who think, well, wait, how can you know more than me? Like how could a Black person possibly know more about art than me, right? And so it's like before we started, Carmen, they talked about Audre Lorde and like having to invent the pencil every day, right? There's a notion that somehow the artist, right? The artists that you see here are somehow not as, that they're Black artists. And that's somehow different than other kinds of artists, right? So you have artists, right, who are almost always white and male. And then you have a queer artist over here, and then you have Black artists over here. You might have women somewhere, but it certainly won't be anywhere near the top, right? And so there's this sort of stratification around gender and race that happens when we talk about who gets to talk about what. Who gets to talk about culture? Who gets to talk about eternity? Who gets to talk about universals? Who gets to talk about those things?
So
I would like the, go ahead.
So there's some questions coming in that are streaming now in a different way. And I wanted to invite that, those questions in. One is around identifying that several folks on the panel have a practice that engages communities. It isn't specific to culture, but community work. And, you know, they want to know how other artists can engage the community in that way. Then another question came in around queerness and how does that impact your practice? So the questions are still moving away from the trauma and from racism and from, you know, the purpose of art. But there is a specific question to you, Shaun, related to your exhibition, specific to your relationship to being in Cleveland. And so I need to check in with you to see if you want to take that question tonight.
Oh, I'm happy to.
So the question is, what would you or did you say to Tamir Rice's mother to explain why you believe in exhibiting the work you made of images of her son's death, despite her objections? Have you had the opportunity to discuss these issues with Samaria Rice or other mothers or spouses of Black children and adults who were murdered by police? And have you been able to change the minds of those who initially objected to the work?
I'm not going to answer that question in its entirety, because the question seems to move from the proposition that as an artist, I should ask permission. And I think that's a problematic starting point. I will say this, however. Yes, I have made attempts. I stand in my purpose in terms of the necessity of the work. I would still appreciate the opportunity, if it so comes, with Ms. Rice. But I also stand in my conviction that the work has the potential of healing and engaging while engaging in the necessary difficult questions. So I will say this. Do I go through a process of speaking to everyone that is somehow depicted in my work? No, I do not do that. I think the question is, we should make a distinction between creating the work and the politics of exhibiting the work. And I wished to engage Ms. Rice in discussing the proximity of that exhibition to her when in Cleveland, and to do so in a deliberate way, with care and with love. I was not given that opportunity, and my initial correspondence was barred from reaching her. I'll leave it there. Thank you, Carmen.
Can I just ask one question to follow up with you, Shaun? Because I know, and please answer as you need. I know I see Ms. Rice's Instagram, and she doesn't have tons of followers, and like there's the foundation, and it's not like it's packed full of like people, which is strange to me because I'm like, you know. So did you work? I mean, when you saw that there was an issue, like she was uncomfortable, did you reach out to her through all of the different channels that you could have, or did it just go out and spin out? Because she feels accessible to me from the Instagram that I've been seeing for years. So I think the question is, did you reach out to through all the channels? And I guess another question I would ask you, if you can answer, is if it was, and I hate to put you in this position, but I'm going to ask it because I have to and want to know. If it was my child and I, because you've known me for 15 years, and I came to you and I said, Shaun, I can't, please don't. Would there have been a different response because you have a closeness, a closer relationship to me, and you know me as an artist? So I'm asking you two kind of complicated questions, but it's something that's been in my mind, actually.
Well, I think that's the same question, because my whole intended purpose of engaging in Cleveland was to first engage with Ms. Rice. And now part of your question is misconstrued, because it moves from the belief that we were in conflict from day one. Whereas Ms. Rice was actually never notified of the exhibition. And so it was months after its cancellation that I even learned, unfortunately, through the media, that she took any opposition to the work. And so we need to be careful about the timeline of events, and we have to also be careful to understand how the conflict was very much crafted by the media. And I believe, had I been given the moment, as I had requested and believed to be coming, that would have been a very different pathway forward with that exhibition.
So there's two questions around the artist's relationships with different environments. And so one environment is the community or outside of the art world. And the other is arts institutions, specifically museums. That is, how do you engage with a museum after it fails? And they use the phrase institutional screw up.
you know, I don't know. For me, you know, I think of myself as, you know, I think a lot about like my civic responsibility. You know, what does that mean and how do I want to serve? And I think it comes back to this place of messenger. You know, when I sort of came to that understanding of myself, I just became liberated in the most remarkable way. I just didn't care about how the work was being received, critiqued. I just knew that I was the chosen one to deliver these deeds. And so it's a different way of existing in the world for me as an artist. And so civic is important to me. You know, I, again, just service. How can I be of service to this larger world outside of my, the privacy of my sort of space? And so again, you know, I sort of, the institutions, the organizations that I perhaps may be working with, again, they provide, I mean, I'm just sort of putting together my team. They're just part of the team. And this, the, this is the agenda that I have in place. And so this is what I'm wanting to accomplish, to achieve. And so it's, I'm only thinking about that as the sort of end result. I do not care about the bureaucracy leading up to that. It's not what's important to me. What's important to me is this sort of, again, the outreach and really being as proactive as I possibly can to sort of, again, it's all about possibility for me. You know, I'm telling you, when I go into, you know, I bring a project to a city, I hire the city to build the project. Yes. Yes, I can bring everybody with me, but no, I'm not interested in that. I'm interested in putting forth this residency, this sort of platform for someone that, let's say, a spoken word artist that I'm working with in a small town that, you know, has only had maybe 50 people at a set. And here I'm like, you're gonna have 4,000. What that does for that individual to think about what is possible. And we all need that one, it only takes one moment for us to imagine what's possible.
So for me, Nick, what's landing on me is the possible or the potentiality for what's possible seems to be tracking back to a statement you made earlier, which is, you know, the institution is working for you. The city is creating the conditions that you have already designed with the clarity of your purpose as messenger, right? That resonates deeply for me because there is still a distinction between what gets evoked and provoked in you, right? As a, you know, in your life, in your experience, while letting what gets evoked move in your making. But that doesn't take you from the purpose that you are clear about. Right. So for me, I really would like others to kind of speak to what you are clear about in this moment. We are near time. And I think this, the theme for me in this moment is power. And power as a material for the artist. because these conditions, as you already pointed out, are known.
Well, I want to chime in and say this, because I want to also tie this last question to something earlier regarding what it means to engage in communities. And I've always said, and it's important to say, that I speak on behalf of no one, but I work with and for. And when I think about this suggestion of power, my relationship with anyone and anybody that I consider community, I do so because it is reciprocal, because it fuels my life. And I will only enter into a relationship with an institution, particularly after one that, what was it, institutional slip or something, I forget how it was framed.
Screw
up. That I will engage with those institutions, or any institution for that matter, particularly white institutions, if they enable that fuel that I gain with community. It has to be able to feed my soul and carry my life forward. Otherwise, institutions only take.
And I tend to think of my practice, I think of myself as part of a community, as part of a group, right? And again, that's where my repetitive nature comes in. I recognize myself as being an arts worker. I don't take it as like I'm this, you know, special, like, oh, the inspiration is gonna come. No, I'm a worker. Like, I'm in the studio, like Steve's in the studio, like Nick's in the studio, like we're writers are in the studio, like the dentist in the office, the writers doing the vet. For me, I'm a worker. I've always thought of art making as work, labor. And as such, I expect things from that labor. I expect the institutions that employ my labor or are engaged with the making to not only pay me well, but take care of the structure of the institution, which is not happening and which I would like to see happen, you know, in terms of the people that are inside of that institution and the artists. The artists need to be taken care of and paid well enough to keep making new work. And so I'm a part of that. And it's not just my work. When I come in, I think about, okay, what are the art handlers up to? How am I treating the guards? How am I talking to the director? I want to understand all the facets of the institution and how it can uplift and be better than it was before I left, you know, after I left it, as much as I can do. And I also always think of myself as a part of this foundation, you know, being a descendant of slavery. And I say that a lot because it helps me to understand and put a lens on what I'm seeing both inside of the communities that I visit and live, what I see on the streets, how I see people living. I understand it, my connection to the incarcerated community that is like abundant and keeps growing. And then I also understand my relationship to, you know, all the other people inside of this country. So, and then my work kind of goes in and out, but I'm also an artist. Like, I really love looking at Goya, right? Like everyone else, you know, I want to look at Carrie Mae Weems. Then I want to look at Nick's work. Then I'm like, oh, Sean, he did that thing. And then, you know, shit, like Sheila Hicks is the bomb. Like, you know what I mean? Like, I want that too. I want to look at Alvin Baltrop's work and like be fascinated and enthralled and turned on. And so I got to be all these different things. And I still have to like consider myself as a citizen in this country. And I have to put that in there because I know the power of art. I know what we can do. And I know that being a citizen in this country means having to push up against all the institutions all the time, even at dinner parties. Some of my cool sweeties are on this right now. We've had those tough conversations, you know, about like, do you speak about this stuff when you're without me? Are you doing something about this? They know who they are. Those are my homies. You know, I want to be transparent. So I guess beyond all else, I'm probably a member of the transparent, not Transparent community, as in speaking as clear as I can to all of the systems and communities that I'm engaged with.
I think it's hard because sometimes you make work and it upsets people in your community. And sometimes you're told that you're not a member of the community. And that's kind of what happened to me in Boston when I tried to do a project. And I think that there's a way in which I understand that, like Xavi said earlier, I don't hold anything against Black people because it's hard, you know. I do wish that I could engender trust in Black people, because sometimes, you know, you've been sold a bill of goods for so long, and then some artist comes along and says that they're going to do this thing, and they didn't consult you, and they didn't talk to you about it. And it's like, well, why does the artist have to talk to you about it? Like, can we talk about what you think an artist is and what you think an artist does? Because I'm not, I don't play requests. Like, I don't, that's not what this is about. Like, this is about me being someone who has tools and abilities to make things that didn't exist before. That's kind of the job that I have. And like, I agree, it's a job. It's not an avocation. It's not a hobby. It's a job. I've organized my life around it. So, and I think that everybody on this call has spent a long time becoming very, very good at what they do, right? So why don't you trust someone who knows what they're doing? Like, what is afoot in the apparatus, the way these institutions work, that sets an artist up as someone not to be trusted? And that's the thing that is like hugely problematic. Like, I'm the artist, right? I'm not trying to fuck with you. I'm not trying to hurt you. I'm not trying to like ruin anybody's memory. I'm not doing any of that stuff. That's not my jam, right? And if you think that is my jam, then we need to have a conversation because you have been misinformed, right? When I did Freddie Gray in Boston, like, I didn't know Freddie Gray. I don't know him. I saw him murdered on television. And my heart was in my mouth watching that over and over and over again. So as the artist, I can make something. And I can make something that, you know, and people ask me, did you check with his family? Did you get permission? I don't need permission. Warhol didn't get permission when he made like that painting of Jackie at Kennedy's funeral. Richter didn't get permission when he did 8 student nurses. Like, no, like, stop
Keith,
with that.
Keith Haring didn't get permission. Didn't he show Malcolm's death?
Right.
Keith Haring?
Right. So there's this way in which, you know, you can, it's part of what, what Dr. Young was saying, like to turn a mess into a message, mm-hmm. is to turn that is the sort of legacy of what it is to be Black in this country. It's the legacy of the blues. It's the legacy of jazz. It's the legacy of Black performance art. It's the legacy of the Black theater. It's like, it's all of those things that where you are given this thing, mm-hmm. and you transform it into excellence, right? And that's, you know, to stay in that place, right? Like, we're all in that place, right? We're welcoming people to come with us. You are welcome to join us. You are welcome to surrender whiteness and be fully human. You're welcome to do it, right? And if you don't want to do it, I can't. And like, stop saying you don't understand it, because I know you understand it. It's the way the world is organized. It's the way this country is organized. I know you understand it. Yeah. When I saw Until and I was walking through and I was like, oh my God, this is so beautiful. It's so transformative, blah, blah. And then I saw the gun. Like, and you see the gun and like everything changes. And once you see the gun, you can never not see the gun again. And that's what art does for you. That's what it does. It stops making you think about decoration and happiness and joy and all that sort of stuff, and brings you back into your corpus, brings you right back into your body. And if you can't imagine after 400 years, what it is like to live in a Black body, like James Baldwin said, as long as you think that you are white, there is no hope for you.
I'm appreciating the differences in the embodiment in your Black bodies. And so, and what the totality of your makeup is bringing to this conversation, you know? Because for me, part of what I'm witnessing is all the ways that we get to express ourselves and make meaning in this environment that we find ourselves in. We have 2 minutes before this needs to close, and I'm wondering what each one of you need to say briefly to feel complete enough to move on this evening. And I want to thank you for being here for this moment.
I will start. And I will say, you know, art has always been my savior. And Black excellence is power.
Child, I got nothing after that. I'm out.
I'm going to say, I actually am going to use this 2 minutes to say, Black Panther icon Fred Hampton's boyhood home facing foreclosure. So can we use our resources to uplift, make sure that this legend, this brilliant mind, family, childhood home actually is preserved? And can we do that around the country? Can we start taking care of our Black history? And I need you white folks to whip out those coins, whip out the coin purse, make it as glittery as Nick's background and make it paper and take care of this. Like we can't do this anymore. We need monument, whatever, however you want to do it. I'm not trying to take everybody's land and all this, but we need stability here in this country. This is what we're talking about. Resources and stability, memory, places to keep these memories, all of it. And then we have to listen to the young folks and what they want to do. But can we start with taking care of Chairman Hampton's home? Because I think there's a movie coming out with some actor. I don't care about the movie, actually. I want to see the actual physical memory that holds all of this. I want to see that preserved.
Right.
So can we do that? If thousands of people are on the call, can we go to the website, figure it out, Instagram, whatever, and start giving money to ensure that in Chicago, this man's home is preserved for our young people? That's my last word.
Dr. Young.
Beautiful.
I think my last word is that artists should continue doing what they do. The institutions should continue doing what they do and realize that our charge is to archive memory, make sense of our cultural moments in time, and occasionally reclaim the voices and history of those who have been lost. That is the charge. That is the work. Do it how you will and in the spaces and locations where you're able to. And do it right.
And with that, we are complete for now.